As we have seen how to get data from a file into a collection, let us recollect details about collections and also basic MapReduce APIs. First, we'll focus on collections and then we'll actually get into the basic MapReduce APIs. So Python supports three types of collections and also tuple. First, let us look into the details with respect to collections, then we'll actually get into the tuples. So the three types of collections that are supported in Python are nothing but list, set, and dict. The basic difference between list and set is that list contain heap of elements, whereas set contain unique elements. So if you just create set with these five elements, it will only return the set with four elements like this. Whereas dict contain key and value pair as each element in the collection. So in this case, dict contain four elements, where keys are order ID, order date, order customer ID, and order status. And each of these keys have corresponding values. So dict is similar to HashMap in Java or JSON in JavaScript. So if you are familiar with any of these programming languages like JavaScript or Java, dict is similar to JSON in JavaScript and HashMap in Java. You can create a list by using square brackets like this and passing elements. So here I'm creating the list. You can see the type by saying type of L. You can get the list of APIs by saying help of L or help of list. And you can go to the list of APIs that are available. You can append to the list using append. You can copy a list into another. You can get how many times a particular element is repeated in the list, because list can contain duplicate elements. You can extend the size of the list by appending elements from the collection. You can get index of an element from the list. You can insert into a list at a particular position. You can remove the element either by using pop or remove. And then you can reverse the list and also sort the list. So these are the APIs which are available on top of the list. So if you want to sort, you can just say l.sort and then see the details of list. The elements in the list are sorted for you. So it will actually perform the in-place sort. It will not return a sorted collection, which means all the elements in the collection on which this sort is applied will be sorted automatically for you. Now, when it comes to set, you can actually say s equal to, as part of the curly braces, you can pass the values. Let's try to pass these values 12153 into the set. You can see the type of this s by saying type of s. It is of type set. You can get list of APIs that are available on top of set by saying help of s. And you can see that it have different set of APIs and most of them are related to typical mathematics set operations. You can get difference between two sets by using difference. You can check whether a given set is a subset or not by using is subset. You can perform intersection between two sets and get common elements from the both the sets. You can perform union on two sets and return a new set, so on and so forth. So all the APIs are typically based on the characteristics of a mathematical set. However, there is no sort here. If you look at the values in the set, you see we got 1, 2, 3, 5, even though we have inserted 12153. It might sort the data, it might not sort the data. In this case, it has sorted the data, but it need not be the case always. Sometimes we might have to sort the elements in the set either with simple elements like this. In some cases, we might have complex objects and based on a key, we want to sort. In that case, we have to use a function called as sorted. So sorted is a generic API which will be able to sort any iterable, whereas sort is only available on top of list. You can get the help of sorted like this and you can see that it can take a iterable as first argument. So you can pass any collection to it and the data will be sorted. If you pass a key, it will be sorted based on a key. Otherwise, it will be sorted in its natural sorting order. So in this case, I can say sorted yes, reverse equal to true, which will ensure that the data is sorted in reverse order. However, the set will not be impacted here. The set will still contain 1, 2, 3, 5 only. Sorted will return a new list. And you can see that even though we passed a set, it has actually returned a list. You can see the definition of the sorted. It returns a new list containing all items from the iterable in ascending order. Or if you say reverse, it will be sorted in descending order. You can also pass a key based on which you want to sort the data. We will see a bit more realistic examples as we proceed further. But for now, I just want to show you how we can actually sort the data on any type of collection. And then we have dict. So we can copy paste this. However, because I have created the content on Windows, it is actually showing Windows special single quote instead of typical single quote. And hence, if I say d equal to and paste this dict, it will fail by saying invalid character in identifier. we have to fix this like this. And now you can see that we have an object called as D. We can say type of D, and it is of type dict. And if you look at help on D, you will get all the APIs that are available on dict. Based on the characteristics of it, we have APIs such as keys, items, values, etc. So if you want to get all the keys from the dict, we can use this keys API. If we want to get all the elements which are nothing but values, we can use values, which is available here. We can also use update to update value of a particular element based on the key. We can delete an element. We can also get both key and values as a set by using items. So keys is to get only keys. Values is to get only values. Items is to get both key and value, and it will return a set which will contain elements with key and value. You also have get to actually read the value for a given key. So in this case, if I want to get order ID, either I can say D of order ID like this, where I am passing the key and will be able to get the value. Or we can also say D dot get, and we can pass whatever key we want for which we want to get the value. In this case, let's say I want to get the order date, and you can see that I am able to get the order date. However, if you pass a key which does not exist in this approach, let's say order underscore which does not exist, it throw key error. However, with a D dot get, if you try to pass a key which does not exist, it will just return null. So this is the difference between using get and using this subscript notation to get the value by passing a key. When it comes to list, if we say L of 0, which is nothing but the index of the element, it will just return the element that is present in that position. If I want to get second element, I can say L of 1. If I want to get second to third element, I can say 1 colon 2. Sorry, we have to say 3 here to get second through third element. So we have to give the length of the list up to which we want to get the elements as the second argument. Now if I say L of 1 colon 3, I'll get these two elements. If I want to get first three elements, either I can say 0 colon 3 or colon 3, it will return the first three elements. So this is how you can use subscript operator on list to get the elements. If you try to do it on set, it will throw error, because set doesn't have a proper length. As we add duplicate elements, as they will be eliminated, the length will always be changing. And hence, if we use index, and if they provide the functionality to return a value, every time it might return a different value. And hence, set doesn't have such kind of operation where we can get the corresponding element from the set by using the index. Now, if you want to get all the keys from the dict, I can say d.keys, and you can see that it has returned a collection for us which contain only keys. I can say d.values to get only the values, and then items to get the items. This is how you can actually extract the information from the dict. Each and every time it actually returned a kind of a collection. And here you can see that each and element is written in circular brackets. And this is what is called as tuple. Tuple is represented in circular brackets. When it comes to list, it is square brackets. When it comes to set, it is like this. Even for dict, it is like this. But dict will contain key as well as value as each element. And then the fourth type of collection, which is kind of heterogeneous collection, where we have elements of different type, is nothing but tuple, and that tuple is represented in circular brackets. So if you want to create a tuple, you can say t equal to, and let's say I want to have order ID, order date, and then order customer ID, and then order status. We can have it like this. Tuple is nothing but an object which contain attributes with no names. The difference between a regular object and tuple is objects will have attributes with names, whereas tuple will not have attributes which contain names. Now to access elements in the tuple, I can say t of 0. It will give us the first element in the tuple. It is similar to the list operation. T of 1 to get the second element. T of 2 to get the third element, so on and so forth. You can also say help of t to get the APIs that are available on the tuple. There are only two APIs, count and index. Apart from that, there are no APIs at all. So this is tuple. Typically, people put both collections, list, set, and dict, and the tuple into same category, but there is a fundamental difference between the two. List, set, and dict are homogeneous collections, whereas tuple is heterogeneous, which means the elements in tuple is typically of different type. Whereas with respect to list, set, or dict, typically they should be of same type, even though there are exceptions. But when we actually understand the characteristics of those data structures, list, set, and dict contain the homogeneous type of elements. You can visualize tuple and list as a row and a table in a database. So a tuple is like a row. However, a row can contain the field names. When it comes to tuples, we don't have the names. That's the only difference between a row and a tuple. Whereas a list or set or dict are nothing but group of tuples. Quite often, we will create a list or set of tuples because we want to create a group of elements, and those elements might have a structure, and if that structure need not be represented with attribute names, then we'll create a tuple for each and every element, and then we'll actually create a list or set of those elements. And hence, it is very common that we create a list of tuples or set of tuples.